Over a decade ago, I sat down with tea expert Sebastian Beckwith to learn the ins and outs of tea and how to brew it well. That afternoon changed my life. Now that might sound like a joke, and I sure do like making jokes on the show, but it's true. Tea still enthralls me, hydrates me, I'm super passionate about it. Today I'm really excited to go over all kinds of information about tea. I'm probably gonna get over-caffeinated. I'm definitely gonna be really animated. Stick around. I don't know who came up with the term fun fact, but if they get royalties for its use, I'm gonna be shelling out some cash for this episode. Because tea, so many fun facts. Fun fact, tea is the most consumed beverage in the world after water. Fun fact, all types of tea, that means white, green, oolong, black, and fermented, all come from the same plant. It's called camellia sinensis. How wild is that? Fun fact, I will not be talking about health today. Now look, I want all of you to be healthy, and tea does have some potentially healthy properties to it. But the reason you should drink tea is the same reason you should drink coffee or wine or any other crafted, beautiful beverage. It's delicious, it's complex, it's fascinating. It'll change your life. Now there's a lot to cover, so let's just put a pin in the fun facts for a moment. So how is it possible to get so many different kinds of tea from one plant? A lot of it comes down to browning. Now often when we're talking about browning in the kitchen, we're talking about caramelization and Maillardization. We apply heat to sugar or a steak or a loaf of bread and we get beautiful browning and loads of flavor and aroma compounds. That is non-enzymatic browning and we pretty much universally love that kind of browning. It's just delicious. But the browning that makes tea what it is, well, we don't usually love that kind of browning. I'm talking about enzymatic browning or oxidation. Tea leaves, like all plants, contain enzymes. One particular enzyme called polyphenol oxidase speeds up oxidation reactions between oxygen in the air and polyphenols in the leaf. The first step in this process is damaging cell walls, just like we do when we cut an apple or an avocado. Let either of those sit around after cutting and they start to turn brown. That is oxidation, and it usually does not lead to deliciousness. Fun fact, with tea, it does. Okay, let's dig into the major types of tea and see how they compare. First up, white tea. White tea sees the least amount of human intervention. New leaves are plucked from the plant and then left to air dry. A small amount of enzymatic browning can take place during this time, but nothing extensive. This leads to very delicate aromatic teas. Next up, green teas. Green teas are some of my absolute favorites, offering a massive range of flavor and aroma depending on where they're grown and how they're processed. The unifying factor for all green teas is they're heated very soon after picking. And that quick hit of heat stops further enzymatic browning. Back to our apple example. If I slice an apple and then immediately cook it, the enzymes are deactivated and we see no oxidation. For many Chinese greens, that means pan firing or heating in a wok-like vessel. That kind of heating introduces our non-enzymatic browning friend, caramelization, leading to nuttier, toastier flavor. Japanese greens, on the other hand, are heated by steaming. As we know from steaming foods in the kitchen, it adds no additional flavor. That's a big part of why Japanese greens are distinctly green in flavor. They can be grassy, seaweedy, and often incredibly savory. A couple important Japanese greens are sencha and gyokuro. To make highly prized gyokuro, the plants are shielded from the sun during the final few weeks before picking. Depriving them of sunlight during this time limits tannin production and increases amino acid production, leading to tea that is incredibly savory and packed with umami. Next up, oolongs. I won't pretend for a minute to be unbiased here. This is my favorite category of tea. Oolong teas are massively complex. The range of flavors they can present is just incredible. Am I drooling right now? Leaves for oolong tea are picked and then purposefully bruised and manipulated to break cell walls and encourage enzymatic activity. This is like buying a bunch of basil, bringing it home, and then mashing and smashing it with your hands, and then leaving it to sit around and turn into a swampy, blackened pile. Except, again, with tea, it's a good thing. After this bruising step, oolongs are shaped, often into tight little balls or twisted into elegant lengths. And then they are finally heated to arrest those enzymes. Sometimes that heating is extensive and leads to toasty, delicious flavors. The best oolongs come from China and Taiwan. And my absolute favorites come from high up in the mountains of Taiwan. The combination of climate and craftsmanship makes a tea. Next up, black tea. With black tea, we reach the pinnacle of oxidation. Never really thought I'd say that phrase. Pinnacle of oxidation. The pinnacle of oxidation. The leaves are subjected to extensive rolling to encourage as much enzymatic activity as possible. Finally, they are heated to halt the process. There's massive variation within the world of black tea and even within regions that are known for their black tea. Take Darjeeling, for example. This region of India produces some of the most sought after black teas in the world. One of my favorites is Darjeeling First Flush, which looks like this. Darjeeling Second Flush, on the other hand, looks more like what we classically think of as black tea. First Flush is picked in early spring and the leaves are handled more gently to keep oxidation in check, whereas Second Flush is more fully oxidized. First Flush, delicate and floral. Second Flush, rich and malty. Man, that's just so cool. The final category of tea I want to get into is fermented tea. The classic example here is pu'er, which is often compressed into bricks and then left to age for years or even decades. Pu'er starts out a bit like a green tea, but the small amount of moisture left in its leaves allow bacteria to ferment it over a long period of time into something wholly distinct. All right, I think it's time to talk brewing. The three factors to always consider are type and quantity of tea, temperature of the water, and length of steep. You can play endlessly with these factors and get unique results. My favorite way to brew tea is using the Gong Fu method. Gong Fu Cha, often translated as brewing tea with skill, calls for a high ratio of tea leaves to water and multiple short infusions. It originated in the southeastern coastal region of China, but is now popular across Asia and in many other parts of the world. Let's go to the kitchen and check it out and learn how to make the very best iced tea while we're at it. There are many, many ways to do the Gong Fu method, but here is how I like to do it. It traditionally uses small clay pots like this one, or a vessel that looks like this, which is called a gaiwan. First, you fill the pot a third or even half full of tea leaves. Here, I'm using tie guanyin. It starts out as tight balls like this, but during brewing will open up like this. Now, I fill the pot up with hot water and let it sit for a few seconds to both warm the pot and open up the leaves a little bit. Then, I dump out this wash water. Then, we fill the pot up again and let it sit for anywhere from 20 to 30 seconds. Now, that sounds incredibly short, but it's because we're using a really high ratio of tea leaves to water. Then, we decant all of the tea out of the vessel into either a mug or a sharing pitcher like this. Now, if I'm just drinking this on my own, I might put it into a mug, but the sharing pitcher is perfect for dispensing into small cups for a group to enjoy. Now we take a taste, sip. That's so good. It's green, it's a little bit toasty, it's something piney in there. Such a complex, wonderful tea. But I'm not done. The beauty of this method is that with good quality tea leaves, you can get multiple infusions out of the same batch. And each infusion is slightly different than the one before it. So we add water, we steep until delicious, we decant, enjoy, repeat. We add water, we steep until delicious, decant, enjoy, repeat. Add water, steep until delicious, decant, enjoy, repeat. Add water, fun fact, some high quality oolongs can be steeped up to 10 or more times. Okay, so I'm clearly using specialized teaware for this, but here's the thing, you can easily do this in a larger Western style pot. Just fill the basket up and make multiple short infusions. To my mind, the Gong Fu method is the best way to learn about your tea and really, really enjoy it. And the best way to make and enjoy iced tea? For that, we need Cook's Illustrated senior editor, Lan Lam, and her recipe for iced black tea. We're gonna start with a bowl and add 1.5 tablespoons of loose leaf black tea. I'm using a lovely Assam here. Then we add 3 cups of boiling water and let it steep for 4 minutes. During that 4 minutes, the very hot water is pulling loads of flavor compounds out of those tea leaves. We have malty flavors, floral flavors, and so much more. Now, anyone who has left a tea bag in their teacup for too long knows that along with great flavor, hot water also pulls out bitter tasting compounds and tannins. We need some of that bitterness and those tannins for a nice cup of tea, but too much can be unpleasant. So at the 4 minute mark, we add 1 cup of ice, which rapidly drops the temperature. Now we can let the tea steep for an additional hour, where the cooler water will continue to pull out great flavor without any of the risk of it turning bitter or too tannic. Then all we have to do is strain and let it chill in the fridge until we're ready to drink. So whether you like it hot or you like it cold, this is definitely how to drink tea. We have just barely scratched the surface of tea. There's so much more to learn. I've got a lot of links below this video that are gonna help you do just that. First up, I have links to Lan's iced tea recipes. She has amazing flavor variations. They're so good. You have to check them all out. Sebastian Beckwith's tea company is called In Pursuit of Tea. He has amazing teas. And while you're there, you can also pick up his book, A Little Tea Book. It's wonderful, beautiful illustrations. You'll learn a ton about tea. Jason Chen's company is CC Fine Tea. He has awesome guides to brewing on his website and even invented a Gong Fu automatic brewer. You have to check it out. And if you want more great YouTube content about tea, I highly recommend Don May's channel, May Leaf. Thank you all so much for watching. If you like this video, hit the like button, hit that subscribe button. Please go buy some tea and start brewing. We'll see you next time.